Taking the exam, this is a big deal. This is a lot of times, I'll just say this now. There are a lot of students, and there's a good chance that you may, you or somebody you know may think this at one point. I knew everything on the test, but I still did terrible. If I had a dollar for every time I heard that, like, I would have my med school tuition paid. And that's saying something, because medical school is expensive. Like, seriously, people say that all the time. I knew everything going into the test, but I still did terrible. And that's not, and I'm not trying to scare you. I'm just saying that the test-taking strategy is very important. This test-taking strategy itself is very important. Again, I'm going to reiterate, you must sleep. You got to sleep. These tests are uniquely critical thinking and deep. You must sleep. Okay, I'm just going to plug that one more time. It's very, very important. But that's before the test. Okay, going into the test, rule number one for me was always be confident. I know it sounds cliche. I know everybody says it. I know it's just like, how do I just be confident? It's almost kind of like fake it till you make it. I mean, you have to kind of convince yourself that you did well. You know, convince yourself you know the material. You know, you've worked really, really hard. Like, everybody else is just as scared as you are. Like, you know, realize that, you know, like, you can do this. Like, she's not going to test you over anything that she hasn't covered. So you have seen everything that's going to be on the test if you've studied. You've seen everything that's going to be on the test. You know everything is in there. You just have to bring it out. So be confident when you're on the test, because I can't tell you how much that, like, helped me. Build confidence, you know, as you go. Like, every time you get stuff right, every time you improve on something, every time you know, if you answered a question right in during your studies that, you know, you kept getting wrong before, I mean, let that build you up, you know, like, you'll grow so much. So be confident when you walk into that test. Rule number two, don't freak out. Don't freak out. Stay calm. There'll be a lot of times when there'll be a question that'll come up, right? And this question is like this word problem, and it's like a patient profile, and it'll say, so Mr. So-and-so is, you know, and diagnosed with something, something, or he's experiencing these symptoms, and, you know, he's, you know, his level, these levels are this, high, low, whatever. It's like, so based on what you know about this, what would you say it is, or whatever? Or he'll have an even longer, like, story question. And it's really easy to freak out on those questions, because you're like, you know, I'm not a doctor. How am I supposed to know this? Like, I'm just, like, you know, in human physiology class or whatever. Like, I mean, I at first I freaked out, too. I was like, what the heck? So don't freak out. Always remember the simple thing that she can't test you over anything that she hasn't covered. So a lot of times, very difficult-looking questions, very long and difficult-looking questions will have a really be testing a very fundamental and easy point. Sometimes those questions will actually be the easiest ones on the test. It's just you have to pick out, what is she actually trying to ask me about that's relevant to what we've covered in class? So sometimes you have to scan. If she talks about some crazy disease in the question that you've never talked about, she's not going to ask you about it. So that's probably not what she's asking about. A lot of times, the information she gives is not relevant. It's not relevant to the question. She's just giving it to kind of see if she can throw you off. Well, not necessarily. She's not trying to trick you, but she's just giving you as kind of like a whole case, like a whole story. But you don't, I mean, like, if she talks about, you know, some random disease like Lou Gehrig's disease or something, like, you know, if she didn't cover Lou Gehrig's disease, she's not asking you to know Lou Gehrig's disease. So there's something else in the problem that's really fundamental that you have known. So usually what you should do if you see a question like that is scan, see if you can find words or terms that you have seen before. And usually that's the part that she's trying to get you to home in on. So don't freak out when you see these big, long questions, okay? Like, she won't test you on things that she hasn't covered, okay? So that's a big thing. Once you see those questions, look for what she's trying to get at. Okay, I will say, time is a big issue. Time is a lot of the reason why people who know everything going into a test don't do as well as they want to do. Sometimes. Not all the time, sometimes. It's a bit of a rush. So, I mean, you can kind of take steps to avoid that. So sometimes on those big, long problems, well, generally what I did, and you don't have to do this, but what I did is if I saw a really long paragraph problem, I would not even waste time looking at it. Don't even, if you, I mean, this is my opinion, but I would recommend not even looking at the question. Just, if you see it's a big block of text, just skip it completely. Don't even start reading it. Because if you start reading it and then you don't solve it, you wasted that time reading it. So if you see a big block of text, just skip the next question and then start it and then come back if you have time. Because every question is worth the same amount of points. And if you spend so much time on that question, you may not get to the final question, which might be the easiest one in the world and really short. So, you know, you would have missed those points that you would have otherwise gotten. Okay, so definitely make sure that you skip questions. I mean, like I said, my opinion, but I strongly recommend that you skip really, really long questions and come back to them later. So make sure, and then another thing I would make sure you do, as you're practicing recall, as you're practicing the delayed repetition practice, I would recommend that you don't stop quizzing yourself on a topic until you can get it not just accurately but very quickly. You know, if it takes you a full minute to come up with an answer, a simple answer, then you don't know it well enough for the test. You have to be able to come up with it very quickly so that you can move on. The thing about Dr. Ketchum's test, and I've confirmed this with her, she agrees that this is how she tests, is she has three levels of questions. Level one questions are simple, are not as common on her tests, and they're just a simple asking for a fact, like, what color are red blood cells? Like, it's a fact, okay? Level two questions are making an inference based on that fact. So, what happens to blood pressure if, you know, you lose half your blood? So, you know, like, based on what you know about blood volume, you guys will learn this later, but you should be able to make an inference on what would happen to blood pressure. Okay, so that's a level two question. Level three questions, are probably, I would argue, the most common, but close second is level three questions. Level three questions take that inference that you make about blood pressure and then throw it into a story or an application of some sort that kind of make you have to kind of reach to try to figure out what that inference is among the story, okay? So definitely make sure that that level one fact that you had to know, because you, if a level three question includes the fact, the inference, and then the application. So you need to know that original fact. If you don't know that original fact, then you can't get the rest of the levels of the question. So make sure that you can get that level one fact very quickly, because if that level one fact takes you, you know, a minute to come up with, and then the level two inference takes you a minute to come up with, and the level three application takes you a minute to come up with, you just wasted 3 minutes on a question. But if you've practiced recall of that level one fact, or, even better, the level one fact and the level one inference, if you've already quizzed yourself over that inference before, if you've practiced recall and it can come to you really, really quick, you can jump, you know, to level three immediately, because you can say, okay, I can get through level one and two. I know that fact. I know the inference. I can immediately focus on the third level of the question, and I can answer it very, very quickly. Instead of at 3 minutes, it could be 30 seconds, you know? So multiply that by a lot of the questions. If you do that on every question, you cut down a lot of time, you save a lot of time, you can get to the end of the questions. So make sure that you don't stop quizzing yourself until you can get it very quickly, okay? Just getting it by itself is not enough. Getting it quickly is crucial. Okay, another thing too, I noticed because I often went in with students afterwards to look at their tests, students oftentimes miss questions, like four or five questions right in a row after they miss a question. So I think what's happening is, you know, if you hit a question and you really don't know and you're rattled by it because you're like, oh my gosh, I had no idea about the last question. Was I supposed to cover that? And you just get rattled and your brain is thinking about it as you go through the next four questions and so your brain's not totally focused on them, so you miss them all. And there's such a heavy pattern of that amongst students. I'll almost see that exact. There'll be streaks of missed answers. So they'll have big batches of really good answers, totally correct answers, and then they'll have streaks of bad, of incorrect answers, because I think that first question rattles them, and the second question they're not really paying attention, third question they're not really paying attention because they're kind of focused on those that first question that they weren't really sure about and they're kind of worried about it, trying to see if they can figure it out. So once you, if you get past it, getting on a question like this really, really, really hard, just put it to the back of your mind. I mean, once you move to the next question, just imagine that you got it right. Imagine that you knew that you got it right. Because you might have. You might have. I mean, there's a good chance that you did. And, you know, you don't want to miss the rest of the questions because you're worried about a question that you got right. So once you get past a question that's really, really difficult that you were shaken by, just, you know, take a deep breath, shake it off, forget about it, and try to just focus wholeheartedly on the next question because it's very easy to miss those following questions. Another thing you will notice, and many people get very upset by this, that Dr. Ketchum tests using a lot of A and B, A and C, B and C, you know, A, B, and C, all of the above, none of the above type answer choices. And it's very tempting if you don't know exactly, like if you know A is right, but you don't know if C is right, and you see a choice A and C, it's very tempting to put A and C because you're like, well, maybe I just didn't know that it was C. It could be C. And you try to rationalize it. If you don't think it's C, or if you're not sure that it's C, don't put C. I actually was counting these up one time, and I'll just say that in the past, it's been a lot more prevalent that Dr. Ketchum would put just A, or just B, or just C. I mean, she could obviously throw a wrench in the works and mess it up. I'm just saying, don't assume it's one of the multiple answer ones. That's a very costly mistake because she has a lot of these questions. I'm not saying that they're never that. You know, they definitely can be that. I'm just saying a lot of times people jump to the conclusion that the other, like if they know A is right and they think C might be right, but they might just be rationalizing that, they just jump to it. I would say don't do that. Don't put C unless you, A and C, unless you know C is right. Or you're fairly certain. Another thing students make mistakes is they, if they see a process question or like a mechanism question, they try to jump into the middle of the mechanism in their mind. By doing that, they like may have missed a step or missed a crucial component that they didn't think about. So when, because Dr. Ketchum loves to test over processes and mechanisms. When you have a mechanism question or a process question, start from the beginning and think step by step to make sure that you didn't miss something crucial that could be, you know, relevant to the question. It's very easy because of the time crunch to kind of just start right where, you know, just jump right into the middle of the mechanism, but that makes it, you're thinking very prone to errors. I did struggle with this a lot because I always just thought, oh, I knew the mechanism well enough, I can just jump to this part. But it's very easy and to make mistakes, and she'll catch you a lot on that. Along the same vein, don't jump too quickly to conclusions in general. If an answer choice, if you see a really, really easy question, look at it very, very carefully. Many times it's a trick. It's a trick question. But in my opinion, if it's either a trick and you catch the trick and you get it right, or if it's not a trick and it's actually that easy, you want to make sure that you get that question right because that's easy points. And easy points is like, if you get easy points in that class, you need to grab it. So if you see what looks like an easy question, take your time because you want those points. And like I said, it's either a trick or it's an easy one. And either way, take your time. And then lastly, I would suggest go back after the test and see what you missed. A lot of people don't do this. I mean, a lot of people do it, but a lot of people don't do this. I promise you it helps. Over time, you'll start to see like what types of questions you miss. I mean, it can be anything from, you know, maybe I just miss the really big story questions. A lot of times when people miss a lot of the really big story questions, sometimes people miss like, I don't know if she does true or false anymore, but sometimes people miss ones where it's like, can you put these steps in order in terms of the mechanism? You know, sometimes people miss fill in the blank questions, like where there's multiple blanks in one question. You'll notice certain, or you might find that you just are weak on a certain topic. These are all really useful. That would be useful for like studying for the final because you'll know what you need to study hard on. Or if you miss a certain type of question, you can start like making like questions for yourself that are like that, so you can practice those specific types of questions. So that next time you take the test, you're more practiced, you're more used to these types of questions. And if you go to Dr. Ketchum's office hours and tell her like that, tell her, you know, I just can't do story questions. I'm sure that she or one of the PLAs or one of the TAs would be glad to make some questions for you. If you go to Action Center, that's what that's for. Go to Action Center, there'll be all kinds of story questions. I mean, I was there. I made a lot of those questions that you may see, or you know, I was there making questions in the Action Centers with people, so I know what happens. So go there and see if you can get questions of a certain type that you know that you miss. And look for those trends. And as you go, you'll kind of figure out what kind of how she asks questions and stuff like that, and what your weaknesses are, and you'll kind of be able to compensate for that. So those are kind of like my test taking tips. Definitely be confident. I mean, this is probably, you know, scary. I don't want you to like think this is just like, you know, a death class or anything like that. Like I said, it was easily the best class I took at OU if you put the effort into it. It really is amazing. And Dr. Ketchum is an amazing teacher. It's hard to find a better teacher at OU. And the TAs, all your TAs are brilliant. So, you know, ask them questions. Don't be afraid to ask them questions. You have so many resources. And they all really want to help you because they all love what they do. And I loved what I do in tutoring. So don't be afraid. Seriously, don't. Dr. Ketchum is the most approachable person in the world. She loves to help you guys, and she helped me a ton. So definitely take advantage of that. Don't be afraid. Just be excited. Be excited that because this class, when you come out of this class, you will feel like a total boss. You will be like, I know everything. Like, I can diagnose that guy. Like, you know, like, you're just like, you'll start diagnosing people walking down the road, and it's crazy. So it's really, really cool. And at the end of the semester, you'll start to, like, when you start studying for the final, you'll start realizing how much you really know, and you'll be amazed. So really take advantage of this class. Have fun. It's a lot of fun. And you know, if you, like I said, if you have any questions, reach out to people. They'd be more than happy to help.